Virginia is a state that I watch, a state that makes me very nervous because Virginia should be a red state. Unfortunately, in an area just a few minutes from here, Northern Virginia, the D.C. suburbs, the population tends to change things. I'm not a fan of that. Virginia needs to be red again. And joining me now is someone who thinks he can make that happen, at least in the U.S. Senate. Corey Stewart is a Republican candidate for Senate in the Commonwealth of Virginia. He joins me now. Thanks for being here.
Well, thanks for having me on.
So I've asked every candidate today the same question. I'm not going to break my streak. What makes somebody in this political climate give up a pleasant, nice life and run for office?
Well, I think all of us are really concerned about the direction of the country. And we also know that we've got a great president of the United States. But he needs help. You know, we don't have enough, Republicans who are going to, who are supporting President Trump. We need to jerk the country back toward the right. We've gone so far to the extreme left that there are a lot of us who are just, those of us who are running for office in 2018, they're concerned about the fate of the country. And we know we're going to take the slings and the arrows, especially up here in Northern Virginia.
Right.
But it's got to be done.
You know, look, I agree with you, Corey. You've got a state. It's a tough state right now because the former governor, Terry McAuliffe, is a money machine for the Democrats. He's been for years. How do you combat that? Are you getting support of the party, of the Republican Party?
Yeah, I mean, the Republican Party in Virginia, like most other states, you've got a kind of a split between, kind of the old line.
The establishment Republicans. The moderate Republicans, right?
Yeah. And those of us who are, with the president.
The
moving
new playbook.
It really is. That's right. I mean, there are those who don't like the change in the party, and those are, frankly, the dinosaurs who get left behind. There's a bit of a split, but... it can be done. You know, I've been able to win in Northern Virginia. My district represent a 500,000 people. It's the second largest locality in the state. We're going to take back Virginia. Kaine, yes, he's got a lot of name recognition. He's got a lot of money coming in from across the country.
Right.
But he also has a lot of enemies.
And he also had a terrible showing as a VP candidate. He really had a terrible showing down in South Florida. That wasn't spin. I went to one of the rallies he had. If there were 50 people there, that was a lot. I felt bad for him. There were almost as many media people and support staff.
Yeah.
As there were supporters. You know, I like to talk about that division in the Republican Party because I think a lot of that has less to do with the ideologies of the party officials and the voters than it does with the consultants. You've got the old mailhouse vendors, that old guard vendor that doesn't want to admit where the world is going.
Yeah.
And I would argue that Donald Trump changed the paradigm, especially with regards to digital messaging, that a president could get on Twitter and bypass the mainstream media, that he could go on Facebook and bypass mailers. We see things like Facebook, the group ramping onto Facebook the fastest is 55 and older with a particular emphasis on 65 and older. It throws those old strategies of mailers into mailboxes that would cost a candidate like you $2,000 to $5,000 per. Now you can go on Facebook for $300 and engage the same amount of people. Are you seeing that as one of the points of resistance?
Well, yes. I mean, during the Republican, I ran for governor in Virginia in 2017.
Right.
Nobody gave me a shot. My establishment opponent in the Republican primary, he out-fundraised me by 5 to 1.
Like 5 million to 1 million?
And yeah.
You only lost by like a point, right?
That's right. I raised $1 million. He raised $5 million. And I lost by 1.2%.
Wow.
And I started with almost no name recognition in the Commonwealth. So... it can be done. I think what your point is well made, that, a candidate who doesn't have a lot of money, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, he would have been dead in the water and wouldn't have been able to get out his message. That's no longer true. And it's increasingly true that you can use social media, more and more people. It's an exponential growth in the number of people who are using social media to keep updated on politics and the candidates that they're going to vote for.
You know, people don't realize something. Right. We have a governor's race in Florida right now, as our governor's termed out. And the estimates for the governor's race in Florida are $20 to $50 million for a competitive race. Donald Trump spent about $50 million nationwide on traditional strategies. But his use of social media, his use of alternative messaging. Now, in fairness, very few candidates have the earned media that Donald Trump did walking into an election. But still, I think he proved that you really can write a new playbook, spend far less money, be quick and nimble, be an insurgent candidate, and win.
That's right. You can, and you know, this is now this brings us to the November elections this coming year. You know, we've got a situation where Kane does have a lot of money, but at the same time that we've done some early polling, his negatives are sky high through the roof.
Yeah.
He didn't have those negatives prior to his run for vice president. So, you know, this idea that he was kind of a middle of the road Democrat, kind of a conservative Democrat, you know, people used to think of him that way. But when they saw what he did, they now, you know, in Virginia, they now see him as a partisan Democrat. And that's why we have a real good shot, especially if the president's poll numbers continue to rise. We've seen over the last several weeks.
He's 3 points above where Obama was at this point in his presidency. You're not hearing that in the mainstream media. That's significant.
And to that point. You know, normally a president, you know, starts off with kind of a honeymoon period, and then he goes down.
Right,
He went down, and now he's coming up, and so the trend is in our favor.
And that's because of policies, which is very encouraging to me. When a politician's trend line is rising based solely on policy, that's staying power. That's not a fad. But I think another problem Tim Kaine has, and I'm curious if you're seeing this, is he came off like a buffoon. He didn't come off as particularly qualified or intelligent or polished or put together. Look, I'm a partisan, but I would acknowledge that I disagreed with everything Bill Clinton did. I disagreed, but I didn't go to sleep at night thinking that he would be completely frazzled when he woke up in the morning. Tim Kaine instills no confidence in me. I could not imagine that man sitting behind the desk in the Oval Office with a nuclear football 20 feet away and being able to competently handle a foreign policy crisis.
And, you know, we have a lot of examples of that. And it wasn't, you know, his, like you said, his debate performance against Pence in 2016, where he was obviously looked like he had just, drunk a...
Okay, he just woke up.
hyper and sweating. And then, you know, when he gave the response speech to President Bush, you know, several years ago, he was... Same kind of thing. He's a very nervous, very kind of an odd person. And Virginians know this. And they're a little bit, you know, people will forgive you if you're a little bit odd, a little bit strange, but they really don't like it in their public officials.
No, they don't. They want to have confidence in you. And I think as the world becomes increasingly more dangerous, as our foreign policy and domestic situations show us real clear and present threats, they want serious people in the job.
That's right. So we think we've got a good shot. We think that there are a lot of races that are currently rated. I don't give a whole lot of credence to these ratings anyway anymore. But, you know, rating, you know, my race right now says lean D. But as a lot
so
of these races
solid
are moving.
D. It's not solid D, right?
Oh, it's not solid D. Now, only Larry Sabato, the left-wing communist professor from UVA.
He's one of your guys, UVA,
But for the most part, they're listing it as lean D.
That's encouraging. And that's a big deal.
And pretty soon, you will see this race move into the toss-up column. And at that point, we've got a real horse race.
We're going to be keeping an eye on it. Corey, when is the primary?
June 12th.
June 12th. You've got a fast one coming up.
Yeah. Yes,
thanks for being here. Corey Stewart, candidate for U.S. Senate in the Commonwealth of Virginia. For all of your CPAC 2018 coverage, stay tuned to The Rebel. And don't forget to subscribe to our premium service at www.therebel.media/shows and go to your app store. Check out The Rebel app.